Hey, this is Scene Detail. I'm Chris. This is MMA for You. I'm going to be doing my predictions for UFC 179, Aldo versus Mendes 2, which happens on October 25th. Overall, it's an alright, it's a good card. I wouldn't say it's a great card. The main event and co-main event are very good. I think one thing that really hurts the card is that there aren't many fighters here that are ranked, or at least ranked in the top 10. I don't even know if you got too many top 15 guys on the card. One thing that you do have on this card, though, is a lot of prospects. Good ones, too. Gilbert Burns, Christos, Giagos, Andre Fili, Felipe, Arantes, Neil Magny, Juan Macario. There's a lot of prospect versus prospect fight. Even in light heavyweight, I guess you can call Hans Stringer a prospect because he's 27. Has a lot of fights, though. Not a bad card for a pay-per-view. Considering that the last card, the whole fight card was just amazing. And the fights turned out to be amazing. I feel that, it's just good enough for pay-per-view, I suppose. I think it's a good card overall, though. Let's just get started. Okay, for the main event, we have the rematch for the featherweight title as Jose Aldo fights Chad Mendes. Chad Mendes has a 16-1 record, his only loss being to Jose Aldo back in January 2012. He has 6 wins by KO or TKO, 2 wins by sub, 29 years old, on a 5-fight win streak, constraining out a Team Alpha Male. He's a strong wrestler with really good takedown defense, really good top control. His stand-up is improving as well, especially under Dwayne Ludwig, and he has shown to have heavy hands. Jose Aldo, 24-1 record, 14 wins by KO or TKO, 2 wins by sub, 28 years old, on a 17-fight win streak, training out of Nova União. He is a UFC featherweight champion. He's known for his very strong leg kicks. His Muay Thai in general is really strong. He has a very clean combo that he uses a lot in his fights, actually. Overhand right, left to the body, right leg kick. He uses that combo a lot. Good uppercuts, good knee, he has really strong knees. And I like his defense in the stand-up. He's not a guy that actually takes a lot of clean hits. I don't think I've ever seen the guy wobbled, even. He does have strong takedown defense. He is actually a legit Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu black belt. There's some fights where you actually see it, too. Ricardo Lamas, 4th round, takes him down with a body lock, and Lamas is a wrestler. Passes over his butterfly guard really easily into mount, takes the back. I mean, so you can actually see hints of his jiu-jitsu in his fights. There's always hints because he never sees his ground game too much. He has an underrated offensive takedown ability too. He actually took down Takeo Mizugaki, Mark Hominick a while back. Of course, I just mentioned Ricardo Lamas. He took him down as well. So he's very underrated as far as offensive takedowns goes. His cardio, though, it's. I think Rogan has a tendency when he calls his fights to overstate Jose Aldo's cardio issues and his weight cut. Yes, he does have this really tough weight cut. Yes, he does have a tendency to cruise when he's ahead. If he wins the first 3 rounds, he'll usually cruise at rounds 4 and 5. And a lot of times, this loses round 5. Usually gets put on his back and ground and pounded, like against Mark Hominick or against Ricardo Lamas. It's just something he does. It's just like he gives away that round. So I'd say his output gets lowered as the fight goes on. I don't think he has like this insanely bad cardio as I know Joe Rogan always likes to point it out, you know, it's tough weight cut, it's cardio that goes down and whatnot. Another thing to consider is that within Chan Mendes' 5-fight win streak, he has a lot of good wins, some solid wins. But like he knocked out Guida, Elkins, some lower tier guys. I think he has Yatsumeza and the guy with the guillotine. I forgot his name. He now fights at like 170 and is like totally overweight for the weight class. Oh, McKenzie. Yeah, Cody McKenzie. I mean, he did beat Nick Lentz. One thing about Chan Mendes is that he'll throw strikes and he'll throw a takedown in order to disrupt the rhythm of a lot of guys. He doesn't really do a lot from top position. He actually has a pretty strong leg kick, actually. Just out of that, one thing that's also noticeable as far as height wise, Jose Aldo is just so much taller than Chan Mendes. Chan Mendes actually looked like a blown up 135er when he fought Jose Aldo, to be honest with you, versus Aldo, who's like that, like a good size 145er, you know, but he's not like ripped or anything, but he's like kind of tall and lanky. Another thing, of course, there's the Ludwig effect. I mean, Chan Mendes' striking has gotten better, for sure. It's also very interesting to see that Nova União's champions have fallen as of late. Dillashaw from Team Alpha Male beat Hendon Burrell. And most recently, Joe Warren just beat Eduardo Dantas for the Bellator bantamweight title. I don't know if that will play a factor in the fight, to be honest with you. If anything, it could be a mental factor. I doubt it. I just pointed it out more just because it's an interesting factoid more than anything else, to be honest with you. With that said, I gotta go with Jose Aldo for the win here. I think he'll beat Mendes in stand-up, be able to defend his takedowns. Even if he gets taken down, I don't know if... I mean, maybe Mendes will still around by staying in top position. I don't know if he can keep down Jose Aldo. I know that, like, I think it's Rogan one time was saying that Mendes throws his punishing ground and pound. Actually, historically, he is not much of a ground and pound guy. He fought, I know the last name was Vasquez. Took him down, Vasquez would try and get rubber guard, and Mendes just kind of hold him down. Every time he took down Nick Lentz, just kind of held him down. Ronnie Yaya, same thing. I mean, he's not a guy that unleashes great ground and pound or anything like that, even when he takes opponents down. He's more of actually just a control type guy. So with that said, yeah, I'm going to go with Jose Aldo to retain. Next fight after that, Phil Davis fights Glover Teixeira. Phil Davis has a 12-2 record with one no contest, 2 wins by KO or TKO, 4 wins by sub. He's 30 years old, training out of Alliance. He's a strong wrestler, has good top control. His Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu is actually pretty solid. He has a really good front choke series. Stand-up's really average. He's a very slow puncher. He definitely tries to adopt the Alliance way of striking, of high movement with high volume striking. I don't know if it really works for him, though, to be perfectly honest with you. He's not a bad kicker. I think one of the biggest problems with him is he does too many lead kicks. And like when he fought like Rashad Evans, he'd throw a body kick and he'd get it caught and then like taken down from there. Glover Teixeira, 22-3 record, 13 wins by KO or TKO, 6 wins by sub, 34 years old. He is a legit Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu black belt with actually pretty good wrestling. It's a decent single leg, so you can get guys down. He's not like a greatest wrestler ever or anything like that. Doesn't have this crazy penetration shot or anything like that, but it's effective, actually. He's a good counter wrestler, too, actually. When he fought John Jones, I think Jones went for some takedowns. I don't think he can really get it on Teixeira. And also, I think he was put on his back like once, and he just got back to his feet, actually. Glover Teixeira's style of striking is inside boxing. He's not a jab guy. He's not much of a kicker. He's more of like short hooks, uppercuts from the inside. He's very heavy-handed, though. Both these guys are coming off losses. Glover Teixeira lost to champion John Jones, where Phil Davis lost to Anthony Rumble Johnson. With that said, I'm going to go with Glover Teixeira to win this one. I think he'll be able to defend the takedowns and have a somewhat similar fight to Anthony Johnson had, where, you know, defend the takedowns, maybe even make him pay for taking them down, and just win in the stand-up. I mean, Phil Davis's takedowns are good. Sometimes he'll shoot from pretty far away, though. He isn't too bad at taking opponents down, though, when they're up against a cage. He's not too bad there. Glover Teixeira, like I said, not pretty good counter wrestler himself. I think he's the better striker and a more heavy-handed fighter. I'll go with Glover Teixeira. I see avenues for Phil Davis winning, especially if he does a lot of the superfluous movement. And he definitely has a way of fighting that looks, Phil Davis does, that looks good in the judges' scorecards. He is the type of guy, 1 minute left in the round, get a takedown, steal the round. Did that against Machida. Or else he just moves around a lot, you know, where he'll kind of, like against Machida, he'll appear busier than he really is. That's one thing that Phil Davis does pretty well. So I can definitely see if the fight goes to scorecards. You know, Phil Davis, like I said, he has a style of fighting that looks good in the judges' eyes. And yes, he probably could utilize it against a guy like Glover Teixeira, who is flat-footed. So there is definitely a method for Davis to win. Pretty much being on his bicycle a lot and appearing to be the busier fighter. I think Glover is probably going to connect eventually. He's a guy that presses forward. He's always pushing forward. And I think he can defend takedown. So that's why I'm going to go Glover Teixeira for the win here. Next one after that, Fabio Maldonado fights Hans Stringer. Maldonado, 21-7 record, 12 wins by KO or TKO, 3 wins by sub. He also has 2 losses by KO or TKO and 2 losses by sub. He's 34 years old. He has good offensive boxing, but his defense is terrible. I say this in every Fabio Maldonado's fights, and it's true. I mean, you can't deny it, you know. It's just, he uses body punches. He punches in combination. He's very good at pinning his opponent against the fence and just unloading. He will take one to give two or three. But like I said, he gets by on having a very strong chin, but being very aggressive and pushing forward, but having very bad defense. If he can utilize that against Hans Stringer, he can probably win. Hans Stringer, 22-5 record with 3 draws, 9 wins by KO TKO, 8 wins by sub. He's 27 years old, training out of the Black Zillions. Stand-up's good. He's actually decent in the clinch, and when he gets his opponent down to the ground, he actually shows some pretty good ground and pound. So like I said, with Fabio Maldonado, like, you know, I don't know, because the thing with Maldonado is he is capable of outworking opponents. He's actually, you know, he's definitely kind of a gatekeeper, actually. He's definitely the type that'll beat your John Volantes, Joey Beltrans, and just some of the more lower level light heavyweights. And it kind of depends if you see Hans Stringer as more of a lower level light heavyweight. He definitely... I was watching, before I did this prediction video, I watched a couple fights. I saw Hans Stringer's fight against Francis Barbarossa. I liked what I saw from his stand-up. He has a good 1-2. When he got on top, he would do ground and pound. He's not the worst wrestler. You know, he's a decent wrestler. And that's another thing, too, with Fabio Maldonado. I mean, his takedown defense is improving. His overall grappling, though, when he's on the ground, I mean, the best thing he can do is get back to his feet when he's get taken down. He's not terrible at doing that. But his grappling, he definitely looks lost sometimes when he's on the ground and put on his back. Like I said, if Maldonado can outwork Stringer, it's very possible. Getting him up against a cage, start unloading those body punches, and just that volume attack. I was kind of leaning towards Maldonado, but you know... And it's tough to say where Hans Stringer really is at in the division. You know, is he an up-and-comer? Still young enough, 27 years old. There's not a lot of youth versus 34 years old. There's not a lot of youth in light heavyweight. He's training at a good camp. And Hans Stringer legitimately is pretty good in the stand-up. And his ground game's not too bad as well. I think also that he'll... most likely be able to get a takedown or two on Maldonado. So I am going to go with Hans Stringer for the win here. I can see it being kind of close. Just in the sense that I can see Stringer's maybe getting some good shots on Maldonado. Maldonado eating them and returning some. So in the stand-up, yeah, I favor Stringer technically. As far as aggression goes, volume striking, I go with Maldonado. But yeah, overall, I'll go with Hans Stringer for the win here, though. Next fight after that, Darren Elkins fights Lucas Martins. Well, Martins has a 15-1 record, 11 wins by KO or TKO, 4 wins by sub, 25 years old, on a 3-fight win streak, trains out of Shooto Box and Macaco Gold Team. That's like Jorge Patino's gym. I want to say like Charles Oliveira trains there as well, if I'm not mistaken. Along with some other pretty good fighters. He's a good kickboxer with heavy hands, and his grappling actually is improving. Darren Elkins, 17-4 record, 5 wins by KO or TKO, 5 wins by sub. That's just 2 losses by KO or TKO. He's 30 years old, trains out of Duneland, Valley Tudo, with the likes of, Eddie Wineland. I want to say Josh Shockley or someone else trains out of Duneland too. Elkins, big for a weight class, and he's a grinder. He's a strong wrestler. He's really relentless about getting to takedowns. He has good top control. His striking's average. He's kind of slow, actually. As far as a striker goes, this is not a strength. But it is improving. So this one was really hard for me to call too, because maybe Lucas Martins emulates a game plan like Jeremy Stephen did. You know, outstriking him on the feet, defending the takedowns, force Elkins to shoot from far away. However, here's the problem. In the fights that I've seen with Lucas Martins, in DFC at least, I have never actually seen him have to really defend takedowns. First one in the UFC against Barboza, he lost that. He fought like Jeremy Larson after that, Junior Hernandez, and then he got a win over Alex White. But for the most part, I haven't really seen him have to defend takedowns. And because, you know, I'm assuming that his takedown defense is improving. And he's being a better grappler. He did choke out, did take the back against Junior Hernandez and get the choke. That was really nice. I don't know if it's his, you know, striking. He's still a striker at heart, though. And, you know, wrestlers have a tendency to be able to dictate the pace. So this one's hard for me to call because, hey, maybe Lucas Martins just blitzes Darren Elkins and, you know, finds a blitz, lands, and, you know, Elkins is out. Or maybe Elkins just grinds away at Lucas Martins. We know MMA, we know that with wrestlers tend to be able to dictate where the fight goes. And that's the thing. I'm gonna go with Darren Elkins to win. I just don't know enough about Lucas Martins' wrestling game, his takedown defense, his counter wrestling, to be able to get back to his feet if he is taken down. I just don't know. Elkins, like I said, big for the weight class. I'd imagine that he'd be able to get takedowns on Martins and work his grinding style to get the win. Okay, next fight after that, Beneil Dariush fights Carlos Diego Ferreira. Ferreira has an 11-0 undefeated record, 1 win by TKO, 6 wins by sub, 29 years old. He is a legit Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu black belt. In the stand-up, though, I'd still kind of classify him as a brawler. He did manage to knock out his last opponent. What's his name? Frank Trent at Pit Elevated. He's on the Ultimate Fighter. I forgot his name. He tends to get knocked out a lot, too. He got knocked out by Tony Ferguson and Miles Jury. How did I forget the guy's name? He has Ramzy Nijem. There we go. He knocked out Ramzy Nijem in his last fight. The thing with Ramzy Nijem, though, man, that guy tries to be like Vanderlei Silva, but he doesn't have the chin, you know? Beneil Dariush, 8-1 record, 2 wins by KO TKO, 5 wins by sub, 25 years old, trained out of Kings MMA. He's also a legit Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu black belt. His stand-up is improving. He was getting tagged a bit by Tony Martin in his last fight. Managed to take the fight to the ground and use his superior Jiu-Jitsu to get the win. So this is actually interesting to me just because they're both Brazilian, you know, they're very strong on the ground, both these guys. I think that Dariush, because I know Dariush is like has a lot of accolades in Jiu-Jitsu. I'm pretty sure he's a black belt. if not, he's very strong in the ground. He trains out of Kings MMA under Cordero. I have seen improvements in his stand-up. Diego Ferreira, though, like I said, like, he's kind of, you know, he's not the most technical striker or anything like that, but he manages to be effective nonetheless with his striking. Both these guys, I mean, their strength isn't necessary in striking, but they're getting better there. So it's really hard for me to say he's going to win. There's some similarities here between the two. I'll go with Beneil Dariush to win this one. Can't say I'm super confident just because they're both pretty similar. I think they kind of cancel each other out on the ground. I'm going to go with Dariush, I guess, to be a bit better in the stand-up, but I can't really be very confident in even saying that. I'll just go Dariush for the win, though. Tough for me to call that one. Okay, on the prelims, William Macario fights Neil Magny. Macario, 7-1 record, 5 wins by KO TKO, 1 win by sub. He's only 23 years old. He was a finalist of the Ultimate Fighter Brazil Season 2. He's 5'11 compared to Magny, who's 6'3. Stand-up's good, and he is heavy-handed. Neil, still not the best on the ground, though. Neil Magny, 12-3 record, 3 wins by KO TKO, 2 wins by sub, has his 2 losses by submission. 27 years old, He's on a 4-fight win streak, most recently beating Alex Garcia, who's a really hot prospect, trains out of Grudge. And like I said, with Neil Magny, he's tall and lanky. He uses his reach and range really well now. He's actually, he came out of that season of the Ultimate Fighter where like Colton Smith won, and he's now like the best fighter to come out of that season. I mean, Mike Ricci came out of that season. He's now fighting in like Titan FC. But yeah, Magny's actually a guy that I didn't think very much of, to be honest with you. I didn't think he'd stay. He had any staying power in the UFC. And now he's on a 4-fight win streak. He's a guy like that fights like every 2 months. Like, this guy fights a lot now, too. And he's finally just understanding how to use his range, uses straight punches. His grappling is improving. I mean, when he goes against like Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu black belts, he does have problems. Like against Sergio Moraes. Or, there's that other one where, like, he got, Magny got on top. I forgot his name, Monstro. I think his nickname is Monstro. Got on top and half guard, got swept him out. So, I mean, he had a problem against, like, super high level Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu black belts. But, you know, he's not bad on the ground. His wrestling's actually improving, too. When he fought, Tim Means, he was mixing in his striking with his wrestling. I can actually see him do that in this fight too, where he'll mix his striking, get some straight punches going on. Maybe get Macario against a cage, go for some takedowns, and get the win there. I gotta go with Neil Magny to win this one. Definitely one of the most improved fighters that I've seen. You know, considering I seriously thought this guy would not have any staying power in the UFC. I don't know if he has like top 10 potential or anything like that, but definitely has. He's definitely a good 11 to 15 type of guy. So Neil Magny for the win there. Next fight after that, Jan Cabral fights Naoyuki Kotani. Kotani has a 33-11 record with 7 draws. 5 wins by KO TKO, 25 wins by sub. He has 6 losses by KO TKO, 32 years old. He's had some solid Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu skills. Jan Cabral, 11-1 record, 10 of his 11 wins by submission, 1 win by decision. 31 years old, training out of Nobu now, and he's a legit Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu black belt. Interesting fight because both of these guys' strength is on the ground. Kotani, I mean, he came back to the UFC, got blasted by Norman Park, just taken down, ground and pounded and whatnot. Jan Cabral, I think, I want to say this is going to be at 155 then, huh? I should have actually checked the weight class because Jan Cabral fought Zach Cummings in his last fight, and Cummings was like huge. I mean, he's just like humongous as a welterweight. You know, so I think I would imagine that this fight's at 155. I think that Cabral would be the bigger fighter here. Probably has a better stand up. Should be able to handle himself on the ground. So I'll go with Jan Cabral for the win there. Next fight after that, Scott Jorgensen fights Wilson Hayes. Hayes has a 18-5 record, 8 wins by sub, 10 wins by decision. He has 2 losses by KO TKO. He's 29 years old. He is a legit Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu black belt. His offensive takedowns are actually not too bad. Stand-up's a bit average. He is a guy that does get tagged. I've seen him get dropped a couple times. Even in his last fight, he fought like this UFC newbie. And he got dropped and I'm almost finished, actually. So his stand-up, like I said, pretty average. Scott Jorgensen, 15-9 record, 2 wins by KO TKO, 5 wins by sub. He also has 3 losses by submission, 32 years old. He's only won 2 of his last 7 fights. He is a good wrestler, his ground and pound isn't too bad. Stand-up's average, stand-up defense is really bad. And this guy's chin has just deteriorated, over the years. I mean, I forgot like this lower level like flyweight, and like it was Scott Jorgensen of the past would have wrecked him. But, man, he was just getting tagged. He managed to win using his superior wrestling. I think the other guy gassed out. But, yeah, Jorgensen's chin just looks so bad these days. I gotta say, I have not been impressed with what I've been seeing from Scott Jorgensen as of late. I gotta go with Wilson Hayes for the win here. I think Scott Jorgensen's a good wrestler. He's a good scrambler. But like I said, Hayes is a legit Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu black belt. He can handle himself well on the ground. And, you know, the stand-up can go either way, I guess. You know, I mean, it's like I said, I don't think much of Wilson Hayes' stand-up, and his stand-up defense isn't that great anyways. And Scott Jorgensen, like I said, I think the only problem I have here is that I think Scott Jorgensen might be the better, might be a little better than striker, bit of a striker, better wrestler, but the guy looks like he's kind of on a decline. That's the thing. That's why I'm going with Wilson Hayes for the win there. Next fight after that, Felipe Arantes fights Andre Touchy Fili. Right, Fili has a 13-2 record, 7 wins by KO or TKO, 3 wins by sub, 24 years old, training out of Team Alpha Male. Stand-up's good, he's really aggressive and always pushes forward. He's got some good knees. Stand-up defense, though, is a bit questionable. He does get tagged a good amount of times. Felipe Arantes, 16-6 record with 1 draw and 2 no contests. 7 wins by KO or TKO, 4 wins by sub. He also has 2 losses by submission. 26 years old, trained out of Shoot the Box and Macaco Gold Team. Similar to Lucas Martins, actually. He does have good Muay Thai, very strong kicks, and it's actually his Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu skills are pretty good. I actually rewatched some of the fights, actually. Fili has some fun fights. He beat Jeremy Larson. Once again, he was getting tagged, though. But he has such aggression and whatnot. I saw his fight against Max Holloway. Max Holloway is just a bit too technical for Fili, and he ended up getting guillotined. Won 3 rounds with him, though. It was a good fight, really fun fight. And I managed to watch Arantes' fight against Maximo Blanco. You know, like I said, Arantes on the ground is pretty good. He'll leave some things open, especially in the scramble. It's not bad off his back. You know, he throw triangle chokes and whatnot. And he does have some pretty good stand-up as well. Like I said, I've always liked Felipe Arantes, actually. I think of him as definitely a dark horse prospect of the division. You know, he's a good fighter. But Andre Fili is definitely one that's one prospect that's coming up as well. He had a lot of hype when he came into the UFC. Very interesting, too, that Fili is coming off a loss to Max Holloway, whereas Felipe Arantes is coming off a win over Maximo Blanco. So this one's really tough for me to say. I'm pretty high on that, actually, both of these guys. I'm going to go with Andre Fili to win this one. Originally, I was actually thinking more leaning towards Arantes to win this one. But I like Fili's pressure. Maximo Blanco, especially in the first round, managed to really pressure Arantes against the cage and start unloading. I can actually see Andre Fili utilize a similar game plan. His wrestling isn't too bad as well, Fili's. He's a good athlete, you know. Like I said, Arantes, a solid fighter. I mean, just good stand-up, good on the ground. Actually, not a bad wrestler. But I'm leaning a little more towards Andre Fili. I think his aggression is going to pull him through. Okay, on to the prelims on Fight Pass as Gilbert Burns fights Christos Giagos. Well, Christos Giagos, 10-2 record, 6 wins by KO TKO, 2 wins by sub. Also has 2 losses by submission. He's on a 4-fight win streak. It's his first fight in the UFC. Pretty much got in the UFC by getting a flying knee victory over Dakota Cochran. Stand-up is solid. He did get taken down by Dakota Cochran. I remember watching that fight. I want to say he just got back to his feet when he was taken down. His takedown defense isn't actually too bad. It's not like he got taken down at will. Gilbert Burns, 8-0, undefeated record, 3 wins by KO TKO, 4 wins by sub, 28 years old, training on the Black Zillions. If I'm not mistaken, he has a lot of accolades in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, and I believe his Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu black belt. But his stand-up, man, in his last fight, I was really impressed with this guy's stand-up. Actually, if you told me that this guy started out as a Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu guy, and he saw his last fight, totally forgot who he fought. The guy he fought is actually pretty good, too. Good prospect himself. But, yeah, if you told me that, Burns was mainly a Jiu-Jitsu guy, I'd have a hard time believing you. Actually, his stand-up looked pretty crisp. He used combinations pretty well. His timing wasn't too bad. I want to say that this fight's going to be at 155. I know Burns has actually had... So the weight cut might be a problem because he fights a lot at 170. And I think there are some times he fought at 155 and had a hard time making weight and stuff like that. So that could also play a factor in this fight. Nonetheless, I mean, there are things like octagon jitters and whatnot. I gotta go with Gilbert Burns to win this one. I think he's a pretty good prospect. Very impressed with the improvements he's been making in his stand-up. And he does have legit ground skills as well. And finally, Fabricio Camoes fights Tony Martin. Tony Martin, 8-2 record, 6 wins by submission, 2 wins by decision. He's on a 2-fight losing streak. Lost to Rashid Magomedov, and most recently got arm triangled by Beneil Dariush. Trains out of ATT. Does have some good Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu skills. Stand-up is improving. His cardio is a bit questionable, though. Especially when you've seen him fight Beneil Dariush. Like, I remember Martin's stand-up was actually looking pretty good, and in the second round, he just, like, looked gassed out. Wasn't the best look as far as his cardio goes. He's kind of tall and lanky, too. I want to say he's, like, 6 foot at 155 pounds. I kind of wonder if he'd be better off fighting at welterweight, to be honest with you. I'm getting my weight classes mixed up now. I think this is at 155. So, Fabricio Camoes, 14-8 record with 1 draw, 4 wins by KO or TKO, 7 wins by sub. That's his 2 losses by KO or TKO, 4 losses by submission. He's 35 years old, and also a 2-fight losing streak. He is actually a legit Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu black belt. Stand-up's pretty average. This fight's hard for me to say because both these guys have a lot of liabilities. I'm gonna actually go with Fabricio Camoes though. I think he might be able to take the fight to the ground. I'm gonna go so far to say I think he's gonna be superior as far as Jiu-Jitsu goes. So Fabricio Camoes for the win there. Not super confident about that pick though. Okay, to recap, the main card of Jose Aldo beating Chad Mendes, Gilbert Teixeira beating Phil Davis, Hans Stringer over Fabio Maldonado, Darren Elkins over Lucas Martins, Beneil Dariush over Carlos Diego Ferreira. On the prelims on Fox Sports 1, Neil Magny beating William Macario, Jan Cabral over Naoyuki Kotani, Wilson Hayes beating Scott Jorgensen, Andre Fili over Felipe Arantes. On the Fight Pass prelims, Gilbert Burns over Christos Giagos, and Fabricio Camoes beating Tony Martin. So that's it for my predictions for UFC 179, Aldo versus Mendes 2. If you have any comments, just leave them below. And that's it for MMA for you. Thank you guys very much.